Well, good morning once again. I am Reverend Christopher Hines, truly blessed and honored to be here this morning. We are going to be in John, the book of John, chapter 8, verse 12, in a sermon I titled, The Light. If you would please take a walk with me into the book of John as I read the Word of God. When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So Jesus says, I am the light. As I get a chance to introduce myself to you, as I gave you a little bit last week, this morning I want to talk about my call. And I'm so blessed this morning to have my two boys here, Brendan and Braden, and I'm very honored to be here, and especially for this story of the call and the light. So about 15 years ago, I had a sister, two older sisters. My middle sister passed away. She was 42 years old. I was 39. She had been sick. She was suffering from osteoporosis and melanoma. And the osteoporosis had actually taken some height from her. She actually lost some bone. And she was very, very sick. She became very, very weak. She'd gone for a routine surgery. And what we thought was routine, but is any surgery really routine, especially when you get put down? I was here in Chicago. My sister was in Delaware. My mom was in Florida. And my mom was on the phone with the nurse before Tracy went in for surgery. We're expecting her to come out, hey, here's she's okay, it's gonna happen. That didn't happen. She passed away. We were devastated. My mom, I'd like to think, within 3 or 4 minutes called me. That was her first phone call. Of course, I was like, how did Tracy do in her surgery? She said she passed away. And, excuse me. So I started getting emotional, and she had to get off the phone to start calling other people. And, you know, my sister was so down with Christ. I know immediately she went to heaven. She was saved. But she had this moment where she came to me. So I'm in my truck. I'm like literally around the block from my house. I'm shaking. I'm crying. I'm losing it. And I pull into my driveway and I hear her. She comes to me and she had been sick. So she had a beautiful voice, but she was talking grass. She had this sick voice. And she comes to me, she goes, Chris, I'm okay. Tell everybody I'm okay. Tell mom I'm okay. So I started, as clear as you can hear me, I heard her. And then what she said to me next changed my life forever. She said, you're going to love it here. You are going to love it here. She said it twice. And then she went away. Things like that happen, you wonder why. I did her eulogy at her funeral. My uncle came up to me afterwards, and I told the story. And he said, you know, you missed your calling. What are you talking about? You missed your calling. That was awesome what you just did. Fast forward a few months, maybe a year or two later, I was working at the post office. And there was a young man, and he was called Preacher. We called him Preacher for some reason. He was a youth pastor at a church, and he was working here in DeKalb as a sub on a rural route with me as well. And I was so excited. Like, I heard he was a preacher. I'm like, ask him questions. I'm like, that's awesome. You know, how did you do it? How do you become a pastor? What did you do? And he's leaning, he's sitting down doing his case, and he looks up to me. You got to be called. What? You got to be called. Like, what? That's how you become a pastor. You get called. And so, again, you know, why did he say that to me? Why did my uncle say that to me? Why did my sister tell me affirm everlasting life? And we try to discern God's voice. To me, this was the light. The light went off for me. And everything that happened in the next, I guess, year and a half was God's voice coming to me. You need to go to seminary. You need to go to seminary. I would turn on the radio, it would be like seminary commercials. A seminary commercial on the radio? Are you kidding me? On sports radio or wherever I was turned. And then wherever I went, it was about this call. So, you know, we think, how's God talk to us? And so here's how God talked to me. Gave me the call. So this to me was life-changing, obviously. So I discerned my call. I went to seminary. And for me to go to seminary, Lord, I could not have done it without Jesus. I had 2-3 jobs, and seminary's almost a full-time job alone. So God blessed me within the next 5 years of being able to pay my bills, to be able to work, to be able to stay above water, and to be able to go to seminary and to graduate my MDiv. And it just blows me away that here I was in DeKalb, and this kid says, you gotta have a call. And then here I am a decade later fulfilling God's call. So think about times in your life when the light shined on you. This sermon's called The Light. Today I'm going to unpack how the light, Jesus the light, blinds us. Jesus the light guides us. Jesus the light saves us. And I add one more to there, that's Jesus' light calls us. Now, this is so exciting to me because if we go to Genesis, the very beginning of the Bible, the light is explained to us. It's unbelievable. So here we have Jesus' light blinds us. So let me just go over this. When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Then we go to Genesis, and in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now, the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters, and God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw the light was good, and he separated the light from darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening and morning for the first day. So here we have the light being shown to us, the very first words of the Bible, let there be light, and the light was good. Friends, we know that Jesus was there in the beginning, there now, and will be there forever. And here it is, let there be light, and Jesus is the light, he tells us. If we go to Isaiah, another Old Testament prophecy coming true. And this one's even more, just blows me away because Isaiah was written 700 years before Jesus was born, before Jesus came, right? And Isaiah says, this is a prophecy. Nevertheless, there will be no more gloom of those who are in distress. In the past, he humbled the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the future, he will honor Galilee of the nations by the way of the sea beyond Jordan. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. Friends, Isaiah wrote about Galilee before there was Galilee. This right here, the way of the sea by the Jordan, this is before they even knew about it. I mean, so he's prophesying about exactly where Jesus is going to show up on the scene and tell us about he is the light and how the light's going to help us. And how the light blinds us. The light blinds us. Think about when that light shined on you in your life and it just knocked you down. It just like I always say, a tennis racket hit me across the face. It's better than a baseball bat, right? It's not gonna be as hard. But Jesus' light blinds us. So when Jesus comes to the world, in our particular lives, each one is filled with darkness. And even now, we think about our sin, and darkness is sin, and think about times where we weren't our best self. His light blinds us. It levels us. It drives us to the ground, and it lifts us up. Like this wonderful story in Acts 9, 1 through 9, about Saul's conversion to Paul on the road to Damascus. This is a long scripture text. I'm going to just explain it real quick. So we know that Saul was persecuting Christians before he became Paul. He was actually on the road to Damascus searching out Christians. So watch this. So meanwhile, Saul was breathing out murderous threats to Christians. He asked the high priest if he could go to Damascus to seek out other Christians in the synagogues at Damascus. I mean, this is Saul. This is Paul becoming Saul. And as he neared Damascus, suddenly a light came from heaven and flashed down, and a voice came to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" It's a great story. And of course, Saul goes, who are you, Lord? He says, who are you, Lord? He says who he is when he asks him the question. Jesus says, I'm the one that you're trying to persecute. Why are you doing this? And then all of a sudden, his eyes were blinded, and he fell to the ground, and he could not see. And he had two men with him that had to lead him to Damascus, ironically, for 3 days. So for 3 days, he was blind and did not eat or drink. I say ironically, humorously, because that 3 days is specific. Specific. So Jesus' light blinds us. Now, Jesus' light guides us. So now watch this. So when Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. So watch this. So we go on to Saul's story, and he goes from being blinded to now being guided. And so in Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias. And the Lord called to him and said, Ananias, I need you to go to Damascus and to ask for a man named Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him to restore his sight. And then Ananias says, Lord, hold on a second. You're asking me to go help Saul. This guy, it's been reported, does harm for anybody in Jerusalem. This is the guy who's persecuting all of us. And he's questioning Jesus. He goes, Lord, wait, I've heard many reports about this man. You want me to go help him? And then the Lord says, go. This man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and the kings, to the people of Israel. So Ananias, of course, does what Jesus asked him to do. He goes there scared. I mean, this is the guy who's killing Christians. And Jesus is like, go help him. Ananias goes, and he goes, 17 there. Placing his hands on Saul, he said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road where you were coming here, he sent me to so that you may be filled with the Holy Spirit. Immediately, something like scales fell from Saul's eyes, and he could see again. He got up and was baptized, and taking some food, he regained his strength. He became Paul. So I love this because we've all sinned in our life, right? We've all fallen short of glory. And if Jesus can take a man who is persecuting Christians, who's actually killing Christians, who's actually seeking out to hurt us because we believe in Jesus. If Jesus could take somebody like that and convert him, what can he do to us? What can he do for us? How can he lift us up? How can he take away our sins? How can he take away our burdens? If he could change Saul to Paul, he can definitely help us forgive our sins, help us love, help us by guiding us into the light. So Jesus' light guides us. It shines like a spotlight on the cross of Calvary. You know, if you need a place to go, you just look at Calvary. That light that's shining on Calvary, that is the spotlight. That's Christ right there. He draws us to himself so that we may find him. How awesome is that? Jesus, our light, is shining on us, drawing us to him. You know, it's pretty simple. If we're filled with darkness and we could see a light, where are we going to go? We're going to go to the light, right? We're going to go to that light. That's what we want. Jesus, the light, guides us. Now, if we move on, it's so many different Bible verses here, and I'm going to skip through a couple of them. But at the bottom one, while I am in the world, I am the light of the world. So Jesus is showing that this is the verdict. Light has come to the world, but people love darkness instead of light because of their deeds were evil. So these things that we've lived in and are experiencing right now, we can just let go because we have the light of the world on our side. If we go to the next slide, it talks about, again, how Jesus guides us, how Jesus was guiding Moses. Okay, yeah, I said Jesus was guiding Moses. When Moses came down from the Mount Sinai with the Ten Commandments, his face was radiant. People could see the light from his face was radiant, and that light was shining. And so we can see how Jesus, the light, guides us in so many ways. It's going to lead me to where Jesus, the light, saves us. So Jesus, the light, binds us, guides us, and then saves us. So again, when Jesus spoke, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Now, I love this next picture. This is actually out of Psalm. David says, you want to know about salvation? Here it is right here. Psalm 27:1. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Again, Psalms was written way before Jesus was born, right? And here we have, the Lord is my light, my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? The Lord is our light, our salvation. So it's explaining that the only way that we can be saved, have eternal life, have our salvation, is by accepting the light. Which brings me to this wonderful allegory called Plato's Allegory. You can go to the next page. This is a picture right here. Now, Plato, you know, Socrates, Plato, everybody know Plato is, when I say that, one of the great philosophers of all time. He lived from 427 BC to 347 BC. He comes up with this thing, it's called the allegory of the cave. Now, if we notice right here, this is a picture. This could be, in my mind, people without Jesus, people with Jesus. So this was written again before Jesus. So the allegory of the cave explains this. There was a belief that the world was revealed by our senses. And here we have three people. I'm going to have to step away just a minute. These three would be considered evil. Okay, they are projecting these images right here that these three prisoners can see. Oh, there's three prisoners there behind that wall. They're chained down. They cannot move. All they could do is see what's in front of them. And then here we have three, I would like to say, people, evil people, showing these holographic holograms, these pictures that they could see. And so one you can see is a bird, a horse, a sun. And so they're stuck here. This is their whole life. This is all they know. All they know is what's in front of them and what's being given to them. And they're in this cave of darkness. And the only light they could see is these images given to them by the evil one. How many people in your life right now do you know that are in a cave of darkness, that don't believe in Jesus, that aren't saved by the light, that are just surrounded by all this darkness? And you talk to them, oh, woe is me, or this is happening, another bad thing. I mean, just darkness. And all they can see, they can't get out of their own cave. They're stuck. But they don't have to be stuck. Because here's what's interesting. You can see a man here at the top. Okay? Now, if you see, he's climbing up. So he actually, what happens is he breaks away. He climbs up and he gets out. And he sees the real sun, the light. He goes from darkness to light. And it's not the image given to him. It's the real thing. Do you guys get where I'm getting to? Real thing, Jesus, the light. So he experiences all this and then goes back down into the cave to where his fellow prisoners are and says to him, you're not going to believe this. There really is a sun outside. There really is air. You can taste it. You can feel it. It's for real. The light is real. The sun is real. What do you think their reaction was? It's crazy. They didn't believe him. They didn't believe him so much that they chained him back up and would not let him go back out. They didn't want to know the light. They didn't want to know what was really outside there. They wanted to stay in their cave. They wanted to stay in the darkness. They wanted to have these images given to them. You know, friends, how many people right now are stuck in their house watching commercials, watching TV, having all the stuff just given to them, having their life given to them in front of them, without experiencing their own light, without getting out of their chains and walking up and seeing and visualizing and feeling and tasting Jesus, the light of the world. Here in the beginning, in Genesis, prophesied in Isaiah, is Plato talking about our salvation of Christ here? Yes, I believe that. I mean, did he know about Christ? No. But here, what better picture of this is that if we could see all the people that we know now in our lives that have not accepted Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, or if we know all the people right now that aren't down with Jesus or don't even have that genre in their repertoire at all, we need to step up and touch them and show them the light. This mind-blowing allegory by Plato is a great picture of salvation. Salvation. Friends, this to me is sad and glorifying all in one. Because you see that these prisoners are chained up. They can't even move. You see evil ones showing the holographics. And then you see their life. And I think about people right now that are in the same exact situation, metaphorically. Same exact situation. They're chained up. They're not really chained up, but they really are in their life. They're really seeing something that's not godly. That's something that's taking them away from Jesus. That's taking them further into the cave, driving him down further into the darkness, when all they had to do is look up. And I talk about this all the time. In my life, God has put me down so many times. All I could do was look up. Think about that. In your life, God wants, he'll let you go so low, not too low, but so low. All you can do is look up. All they could do is look up. Finally, friends, this leads to our call. Before that, in 2 Corinthians, it says, God who said, let the light shine in darkness, makes his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of knowledge of the glory of the God, the face of Christ. Paul gave us that. And we can see that it leads to our call, which is something, should be the next slide. So our call, I believe that as a church, we are being called to shine God's light. How many times have you seen, oh, I want to be the lighthouse. We're the lighthouse. You know, if a ship's out to sea and it's total darkness, the only thing that ship can see is that light, that lighthouse. Think about everybody right now in DeKalb, your loved ones, friends, family, people you don't know, people at the university, just everybody around, people that we deliver mail to, everyone. If they are in darkness, it is our job. God is calling you, calling me, calling us to show them the light. To be the light of DeKalb. To be the light of the world for Jesus, for him. We're going to do his work for him. I'm going to reach out to somebody who I know is hurting. And I'm going to say, look, you need to experience the light of Christ. Because the light will heal you. The light will shine on you. The light will take you to where you need to go, which is out of darkness, out of the cave. So many people right now, within a stone's throw right now, are in a cave, stuck. Chains from the evil one. Showing visions from the evil one. Stuck with all this darkness around them, and we have to step in to their life just like Christ and be the light of DeKalb. We need, as a church, we need to shine our light. There's so many people right now that are filled with guilt. This morning, if I could take that guilt away from you, acknowledge that, yes, we are going to suffer through this guilt. But we need to know that the light of Christ will illuminate your sin. A response to this sermon would be confession. Lord, I sin. Please forgive me. Again, in our call, we need to show grace. There's so many people right now that need to be filled with the grace of Christ. Again, the light of Christ illuminates the cross where Christ died for us. That's all the grace we need. Christ died for us on the cross. How much more grace do we need? And then gratitude. We need to have gratitude. So some of us here this morning are stuck behind that cave, inside that cave or behind a dark light. And maybe not specifically here, maybe they'll see us and hear this. They need to know about the gratitude that comes when we accept Jesus as our personal Savior, when we accept Jesus as our light. You know, it's almost like that burning bush, you know, that Moses saw. That light right there. We need to shine that light so that we can take people away from their guilt, give them grace, and fill them with gratitude, and be the lighthouse of DeKalb as First Baptist Church of DeKalb. We need to let our light shine. Now, in Luke 8:16, it says, no one lights a lamp and hides it in a jar or puts it under a bed. Instead, he puts it on a stand so that those who come in can see the light. Friend, you are the light of Christ. We need to take this light home and extend it to our family. We need to show this light in our workplace. We need to show this light to Bear fans when they're winning and losing. We need to show this light to Cub fans, to everybody, friends. We need to show the church. Let the joy overtake the sorrow. Let your light shine in all of your relationships, all your associations. Let it shine in the city of Chicago, to the suburbs of DeKalb. Let it shine among the rich and the poor, among your friends and your enemies. Let the light of Christ shine so that everyone can feel the love of Christ. Friends, Jesus the light blinds us. Jesus the light guides us. Jesus the light saves us. Jesus the light calls us. So let the light of Christ, let his love shine through you. Let his character shine through you. And let his word shine through you. So the people of God, let us shine in this world of darkness. Let me pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for this scripture text. Thank you for being our light, the light of the world. Lord, it is with your light that we can shine your love. And as we do that, Lord, we feel your love. We feel your goodness. We feel your mercy. We feel your grace. So, Lord, we ask you to help us be the lighthouse. Let our church here, let the First Baptist Church of DeKalb be your lighthouse for the people of DeKalb. And Lord, let your light shine through everyone here today. It's in Jesus' name I pray. And all God's people say, amen.